think we should be prepared to vote on it this evening.
Any other questions or comments before we consider a motion?
We do not yet have, we've not heard anything from the EPA or the Army Corps of Engineers.
Changed the ballgame on us last month by talking about the weir. So anything that was involved with our prior discussions with the EPA and the DPA and the Corps of Engineers is now out the window.
Would you explain that a little further? What do you
mean? The subdivision approval required wetlands alteration in excess of anything described in our correspondence with those other regulatory agencies. When we dealt with those other regulatory agencies, we dealt on the basis of the proposal made to the board. The board found it appropriate to approve our proposal with a condition that changed the wetlands impacts for the project. Therefore, any correspondence that we have had with outside regulatory agencies really wouldn't apply because we have a slightly different situation. Our intent is that that we will obtain all necessary permits and approvals in the interim between preliminary plan approval and our application for final plan approval. That is the way that the ordinance contemplates you go.
Are we ready for the motion?
Would someone like to entertain reading it?
Madam Chair.
Moving it.
I would move that we order that the request of the Ibis Corporation for a planning board permit for wetlands alteration for Dyer Pond Road, a proposed 8-lot subdivision located off Shore Road, be granted according to Section 19.39 of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented subject to the following conditions. That septic systems shall be placed far enough away from wetlands to ensure proper filtering. B, that any conditions attached to preliminary or final subdivision approval shall be applicable to this planning board permit. And C, that no construction or wetland alteration activity shall occur until after final subdivision approval is granted by the planning board.
Is there a second?
Second.
It has been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Opposed? It is carried 3-1. And you have your wetlands alteration permit. And Mr. Butler has a word to say.
In respect to resource protection, I did find Mr. Taylor was correct. October 1st, he did submit some documentation, which became buried in the huge pile. It appears from my cursory re-review of this that he's met all the standards. The question would be to the board, because it's very similar to wetlands alteration in terms of the standards. The issue to the question of the board would be, given the fact that you probably would have to dig it out of your files too, do you want to include that, or do you want to entertain a motion to that respect tonight, or would you prefer to wait until final plan approval? I guess I also asked the question of the applicant what his preference would be.
One more member, once again, it's not something that was on our agenda. I think we're running late, and I would like, for one, to see it tabled for later.
With the final application.
Yes. I would prefer to see that also.
Madam Chairman, if I may, the application was made on a timely basis. The information was submitted on a timely basis. The project has received significant discussion, including discussion of the need for construction in a resource protection zone, which requires a planning board permit. It was, requested. We, the applicant, have consistently granted extensions in the time period for consideration as a part of the mutual effort in seeing that the project is fully considered. Quite frankly, it's a shock to me that the subdivision plan approval doesn't, in effect, is not in effect. Permission for construction and resource protection district, because that was a part of the basic application. And it is inherent in the plan before you. So I am wondering if either we aren't chasing an unnecessary additional step because of the nature of the application, the nature of the plan, the nature of the information, or alternatively, if the board, from a fairness perspective, could examine this tonight, because if there is a condition or a rejection that's here, it could again change all the applications that are necessary to the other regulatory agencies involved. So I'm quite frankly a little bit confused as to where we are and where we should be, and so I would ask the assistance of the board as to where are we and how can we proceed in an expeditious manner.
Madam Chairman, just to respond, turns out that Mr. Taylor did submit the information with his original packet and with his wetlands alteration information. On the other hand, according to the zoning ordinance under the Resource Protection District standards, a separate planning board permit has to be issued by the board, very similar to the wetlands alteration. And therefore, although the materials were submitted, I hear what Mr. Taylor's saying in terms of wanting to get the request tonight. I guess the one point I'd like to make is that approval of the planning board permit for resource protection alteration, in my mind, did not occur during preliminary plan approval. That leaves open the question what the board wants to do tonight with resource protection.
I guess I would stand by my previous statement that I would like to consider this at another time, but I'd like to hear other board members.
I stand by what I've said too. And I listen to what Taylor saying, and it sure sounds from what he's saying like there was an oversight or something like that. And I'm wondering if there's not a possible compromise here. I hate to throw things into an agenda next week, it's going to be very low, but...
Sure, by your shoulders.
Is it possible for staff to review the situation and brief us sufficiently so that we could handle this at our meeting next week? I mean, a week's
way,
I apologize for it, but at least we do have an opportunity to do something with it.
Right. From the staff's perspective, I think that would be very easily to be done. I mean, I feel comfortable in actually doing that tonight, but if the board wants that additional time, there'd be absolutely no problem in doing that in time for the next meeting.
What is the board's pleasure? I think I would prefer to see that occur.
I guess I have a question as a member of the board. I would have thought that Resource Protection District would have been discussed during preliminary plan review, and I'm sure it was, and considered. And to me, once you give preliminary plan review, that final plan review is really a pro forma review process to make sure that all of the conditions have been met or any additional standards based on the preliminary plan approval, which you did, you conditioned the preliminary plan approval. But tonight we talked about wetlands, we talked about the road, we talked about filling. You approved the preliminary plan at the last meeting. Are there really substantive issues for resource protection that still remain before the board? Or is it just another step to go through? I mean, all of those issues have been discussed, presumably.
If I may, it appears to be primarily procedural. In my opinion, but that's my being able to look at the information in front of me.
We have a difference of opinion, I guess. We are arriving at a difference of opinion as to whether to consider it tonight or put
no, I'm not. I'm not asking for it to be considered tonight. And I think it's appropriate to do it in the next meeting. Things have to be prepared. Your analysis has to be done, and the board has to look at that and approve. So it should be next week, if that's a separate set we have to do.
It sounds like it's something that we could dispose of pretty quickly at the next meeting, too. So that's what I want to do. Should we make a motion at this point to table? It's not going to be before us. It's before us, I guess, but it's not before us, so maybe that's just...
Just to put it on the agenda. And since it would be under old business, we perhaps could... Perhaps at 8:25 on the 22nd, and we apologize for not bringing this to the forefront sooner.
Well, I appreciate the board's indulgence in scheduling it for consideration on that a week from now.
See you the 22nd, and you have your wetlands alteration permit.
Thank you very much.
Our next item of business is Ponto Subdivision, and that is a minor subdivision coming in for review. Ponto Subdivision is being represented by the firm of
Owen Haskell,
and you are here to make the presentation.
Yes. Good evening. My name is Jim Barker. I'm from Owen Haskell, representing Ponto Associates in their submission for the five-lot minor subdivision located at the corner of Ocean House Road and Shore Road. We were here, I think it was two meetings ago, briefly to give an introduction to the project. Just in review, it is, as I stated, a five-lot minor subdivision located next door to the town hall at the corner of Shore Road and Ocean House Road. Two of the lots shown on the plan, Lot 1 and Lot 3, are presently existing lots under leases and have been so for approximately 25 years. The remaining property is a T-shaped piece of property that presently has three buildings on it, and the proposal is to break the three buildings up and the surrounding land into three separate lots that could be sold to separate ownership. In quickly reviewing it last time, there was a concern expressed as to control that the planning board may lose in approving this towards future use and changes to the lot. In addressing that, we've added a note to the plan. It's note 7 in the list of notes, and reads, any proposed changes to the configuration of the improvements on lots 1 through 5 or changes in existing uses of lots 1 through 5 after the date of approval of this plan require site plan approval by the Town of Cape Elizabeth Planning Board, and we felt that this would adequately address that problem of control, future control by the board. In talking with Mr. Daigle subsequent to the meeting last time, he had also mentioned some other concerns that had been expressed to him, and I've tried to address those in a memo to the board. There were four concerns that he had expressed, and I can just briefly review those if you'd like. The first was a setback problem by creating the new division line between lots 2 and 5. There was a setback nonconformance caused by that due to the fact that there is only approximately 17 feet between the professional office and the apartment house. And to deal with that, we are presently have a application before the Zoning Board of Appeals to get a variance for that. The concern also was expressed that we have shown a proposed utility easement running to Lot 4 in the storage barn that would have a new sewer and water line installed. And I guess there's been some concern that maybe an immediate change to the use of that lot is planned. But as I've mentioned in the letter, that Pond Cove Associates want to assure the board that they have no immediate change in use of the storage bond. It will continue to be used that way. They have shown the easement and the proposed utility service merely to do it now, feeling that this is a more appropriate time than to wait until such time as they're trying to sell the lot. That way it would already be created. There would be no problem in getting that granted by another lot owner. This also, I think, would be covered by the additional note that would require approval by the board. A concern over traffic was expressed, I think was some discussed briefly at the last meeting. Due to the fact that no proposed changes have been made, we feel that this issue would be something that should be dealt with when there is a site review for the individual lots. In proposing these new lots, actually there would be probably a slight decrease in traffic due to the cessation of access to the Westcott property and to Lot 5 from Ocean House Road. The last issue was one of drainage. There presently is surface drainage coming from Lots 3 and 4 into a catch basin on the town property. That's something that's existed for quite a while, from my understanding, along with a 4-inch garage drain that comes from the Irving gas station that dumps into the catch basin. And there's been a concern as to pollutants being dumped into the catch basin and subsequently out onto private property. And dealing with that issue has been a recommendation, a requirement that an oil trap be placed in the drain in the gas station, and that is something that is going to happen.
That has not been done yet.
It hasn't been done yet.
But,
and two, we've got it's an existing drainage situation that's never really been addressed through deeds or any other official documents, and so we would like to propose to the town or have the town issue a convey easement to allow this drainage to continue, thus making the existing situation official at that point. That is a proposal that we've shown on the plan and like to discuss. But if there are any questions or concerns of the board.
Thank you. Are there any questions of board members? I understand that you would have to gang up on a sewer service connecting the service station with the storage barn.
Yeah, we've shown a connection from the service station into the line that's running from the barn. That would be covered through easements. Basically, it would be an easement to the to Lot 4 across.
Have you been to the Board of Sewer Appeals to do that, to get permission to do that?
Permission for to install the lines? Is that?
To have a doubling up there.
No, we haven't.
I guess I'd have to ask the code enforcement officer or the building inspector whether the multi-purpose gentleman in the back row about that.
I believe that question has to be asked in the Public Works Superintendent. Under our existing ordinance, he had the authority to issue that, although I don't believe it was his recommendation. He wanted it joint. They've already spoken to Bob Nally, and I suppose it's something we can get in writing and request it.
I think that would be helpful. Just a letter note
recommending
that has been recommended and has been approved. Are there any other questions?
Madam Chairman, what is the proposed 20-foot drainage easement off to the right of the property? Is that proposed? proposed drainage easement that you're proposing?
We would propose that that be issued by the town to the Pine Cove Associates, or specifically to lots 3 and 4. It's a condition that exists now, has never been formally addressed before, but has existed for quite a while.
Do you anticipate taking that to the town somehow, the town manager or whatever?
Yeah, we'd have to get it through the town.
Okay, I'm not sure that this board can grant drainage easements across town property, and that's something that would have to be formalized somehow in the town government.
Okay.
Has there been any thought given to perhaps increasing the buffer between the town hall and the Irving station and improving the buffer there?
As far as a visual buffer?
Yeah.
Not specifically. We haven't discussed that specifically.
Is that something that the applicant would be willing to consider?
My name's Gerald Murray. I'm a principal with the Pine Cove Associates. I believe that there's a 25-foot right-of-way that runs from the town mark to Pine Cove. There's a 25-foot right-of-way to the back property, and I don't know how that would be addressed without removing the 25-foot right-of-way. It runs from the fence 25-foot into the shelves or the Irving Oil, and that's the location of their underground tanks is at 20.
So
I don't.
So there isn't any.
There isn't any. No.
Through fencing.
Yeah, there's a fence there, but that's probably the extreme. It was never been activated, but it's been in a deed to Irving Oil that we have 25-foot access.
It's not your intention to use that right-of-way to get back to the storage barn?
I wouldn't think so. We have a 35-foot right-of-way on the other side.
I wonder if there's any possibility of contributing that to the town, the right-of-way, and that 25-foot.
Well, right now it's in a long-term lease with Irving Oil, so we really don't have any control on it at this point.
Okay. Any other questions? Comments?
Now, Chairman, we don't have a suggested motion for approval for this, do we?
No.
And the reason is that having gone over the checklist that's required for minor plan subdivisions, that there are some pieces of information that are missing, and you should receive that in the mail to be added to your packet. Some of them are relatively minor, such as the lack of a north arrow, very minor.
I think we have one up here.
Oh, never mind. Okay. Other in terms of the, I put down for a depiction of surface drainage patterns, if it's partial, drainage patterns for the entire site are not evident. And I have a copy of the checklist for the applicant or his representative if he'd like to see it. Soils information also isn't provided. Again, the board may want to decide whether or not that's required. At this point, that has been waived. No stormwater management plan. Statement of technical and financial capacity, I don't think is in the application packet as well. Information about electrical facilities, it may be on the plan, but they're hard for me to pick out, so I left that blank. And then copies of any covenants or deed restrictions, which would probably include some of the right-of-way language we should take a look at as well as any written evidence of easements in public open space. I'm not sure that's a big issue, but you do have some easements over the property, and I'm not quite sure what they do and who they're to and all the rest. Those are things that I think the board should try and get.
What question? Just purely a question at this point. Seeing that one of the lots does contain a service station, we have a right to inquire the status of the tanks, transportation tanks, or any plan DEP might have for replacement of tanks, underground tanks?
Into fiberglass, you mean?
You can ask.
There's a provision that says any other data requested by the planning board. If you think that's irrelevant to the issue of the subdivision approval, I would think that you could ask for it.
If that's going to be continued use on this lot, that's a question.
I think that's a good point and something that environmentally we should be sensitive to.
Madam Chairman, if I may, another question I had in reference, in addition to these others, and it relates to the easement, is in terms of access to, I guess, the lot 4. And I'm assuming that the access would be provided via the right-of-way, the proposed right-of-way. That's somewhat unclear. Is that?
Yes.
Maybe tell us in more.
Yeah, it presently comes through there and would continue to.
Any reason for that width? I mean, it's just that in the future you wanted to put a roadway in.
The 35-foot right-of-way exists under the lease, as stated on the plan. The back section that runs across Lot 2 in front of Lot 4 is a proposed extension of that.
Okay. So the right-of-way or the existing traveled way that goes back behind Lot 2 and connects Lot 5, as well as the driveway of Lot 2, would no longer be continued? Is that correct or not?
There'd no longer be access through this road system to Lot 5 because you'd be crossing Lot 2 at that point.
Okay. Madam Chair, one further question. In terms of the gravel drive and its current use by the property to the north of the subdivision, it says Eleanor Westcott, what would be the future status of that right-of-way?
There would be no right-of-way for that. Okay. The access through the property would cease to exist through legally.
Any other?
Madam Chairman, I'm a little confused by that last statement. Currently, there is a right-of-way through the gas station. That house
indicated
as being on Westcott property.
There's no legal easement of record.
I may speak on that. The Westcott property has used that as an access, but they have no, you know, there's no, the Bon Cove Associates has access over that only, and the tenants or the leasees. They just used it in it. Of course, naturally now it would be cut off if it's sold.
I'd just like to bring the board's attention that we'll be hearing, I guess at the, double check my agenda. March 22nd meeting, we'll be hearing the beginning discussions about a site plan review for a proposed new facility on the Prescott property. Again, we may want to ask ourselves, in terms of that the current use, part, you know, the activity that exists there now, some of the vehicles, I assume, use that right of way, and we may want to ask or at least look at the impacts upon Shore Road versus Route 77 in terms of what will happen once the subdivision is complete and that access onto 77 is no longer available.
If I can address that, I think there's only been passenger type cars or pickup type. The road is not suitable for any tractor trailers or dump trucks to negotiate the corners in there. They've just shot through there as a shortcut. You know.
What is the right-of-way per lease that cuts through the gas station property on the northern side of the property and then through Lot 4 and seems to extend toward the Westcott property?
There's two rights-of-ways in the lease for Irvin Oil. Those are the ones you're talking about? That we left that when we wrote the lease 30 years ago. We wanted to be able to have access to our own property in the back. And so we had the 35-foot right-of-way on the north side and the 25-foot on the south side. The 25-foot was never utilized. They can't, in their lease, they can't do anything. We can't block it. They can't block it. They can't put signs there. They can't put tanks there. It's just written in as a access for the back properties.
the back property.
But they do have a tank on it.
No.
Mm-hmm.
No, it's a
little, is that dot not a tank?
That would be a number two fuel, on which side?
Well, on the left-hand side as you look at the right of way.
Yeah, that's a number two fuel oil. It's a 500-gallon tank. It's quite a ways from the right of way, I think. It's right beside the building, if I'm looking at the right one. You're looking at proposed easement for the sewer and water, I believe. You're talking about the rights of ways?
No. The right of way between the Irving Station and the town hall is a...
25.
Hmm?
25 foot?
Yes, a 25-foot easement. Right above the line that says 25-foot, looks like there's a tank there.
Tank. There's a filling point for the tank.
In the right of way. It looks like it's in the right of way.
It's very close.
On the line.
Madam Chairman, is there any reason that we can't approve this evening? The issues that have been raised as issues that aren't here are issues that we would typically look at as we're looking and reviewing a proposed subdivision. And as we talked about in the pre-application meeting, this is the parceling off of existing properties that there are no changes being suggested. Do we really need soils information? Do we really need some of those other issues? Or can we waive those as requirements of the subdivision given the peculiarities of this application?
I think we certainly, this is up to the board to judge tonight, we certainly could waive some of these things, such as the soils report, the stormwater management plan, possibly. I don't know how the rest of the board feels about this. I think it's very possible to give a dated receipt, and we might want to consider a public hearing since this is in a corner which is abuts a great many neighbors. That's something too that the board might want to think about. We could do that if that's your pleasure, or I think we could move forward to a we don't have written evidence from the town manager and town attorney regarding legal documents, which is something that we might want to do before we get approval.
Legal documents for the right
the easements, the right of way, and that.
Couldn't they just be
a condition?
Waive the soil test and vote on it. I certainly would be in favor of that.
The secretary reminds me that as a minor subdivision, all the abutters have been notified so that if they had wanted to make public comment or have input, that could be done tonight. I don't know, are there any neighbors here tonight that are interested in this project? Just as a question. What is the board's pleasure?
Madam Chairman, I would move that we issue a receipt for a completed application and that we approve the preliminary plans as presented.
Second. Is there any discussion? All those in favor, please.
Madam Chair.
Pardon.
Just so you know, that this is a minor subdivision, so when you approve, you're approving once.
Right.
So you'd be approving the final plan.
Good.
Agreed.
In light of that, Steve listed off a number of items which were minor, but there were a few items that might not be considered minor. So, as much as I'd like to get something off the docket as expeditiously as possible, I just want to be sure that we're not missing something very important. Steve, do you have that list? Do you see anything that?
Two things that I think one bothers me somewhat. One bothers me just a little. One is, I think we need to make sure and ensure that there's adequate electrical service to all lots. I'm primarily concerned about lot four, I believe, is in the back. Again, I think we all assume that that's the case.
Couldn't we condition approval?
Yes, on that one. The other aspect is, I think we also need to make sure and just clarify that lot, that all the lots do indeed have access out to the road. And I guess, again, lot four is a major issue. If you feel that what's presented here is adequate, and you might want to, again, condition that based on getting a copy of the right-of-way language, so you'd have, you'd be assured that lot four does indeed have access up to the roadway. I guess that's my primary concern, is making sure lot four does have indeed have adequate access out, and then secondarily, just to ensure the electrical service is provided. Those are the two major issues that I have.
Well, I've got one to add.
Okay.
In light of question I raised, in light of the fact that it looks like this is really continuing existing use of this property and into the future, and one of those uses is a gas station, I would like to raise the question that we condition on the gas station storage situation be addressed. Satisfactory result, this is the moment you got.
I'm sorry, I couldn't quite catch that.
Would you,
Tanks, underground tank storage, that whole question of whether these tanks are to be replaced or not.
The condition of them and what the future plans would be?
Yeah.
Just a statement of that?
Right.
So we have three conditions that we're talking about to make this motion contingent on: the electrical facilities, the access for lot four, and assurance that lot four has access. And the statement about the storage facility tanks.
Underground.
I might add a fourth, and that is just to go along the lines that the 20-foot drainage easement be reviewed and approved by the town attorney and town manager.
Oh, okay. I was going to say it's been reviewed by Bob Hunter for the.
I'd say just in terms of, okay, and I'd add him too, just, and we need evidence of all of that.
Yeah, he's been through
that. Yeah, but I think we need to make sure that that's all taken care of and the town agrees with it, that's all. I mean, so we don't end up with something that technically may be adequate, but legally is a problem and holds you up and it creates a problem with the town.
For the easement, the access easement for lot four and the proposed utility easement for lot four, basically you need to see a copy of the legal document ready to be executed.
And I'd say it'd be subject to review and approval by the town attorney.
Yeah.
Just again to make sure that everything's all set. We don't want to hold you up. We want to make sure that we don't approve something that when someone comes back later on and asks some questions of the town.
I guess we had a motion which has been made and seconded. Would the original motion maker be willing to amend his motion to add that this be contingent on the four now conditions that have been mentioned?
And those are?
And those are that the electrical facilities be all intact, the assurance that lot four has access, that there is a statement from the Irving Station about the underground storage tanks, and finally that any written evidence be turned over on deeds, rights of ways, and easements to be reviewed by our town attorney. Does that cover all our
Sure. bases? It would be a pleasure to amend the motion to that effect.
All right. Is there a second to the amendment? All those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's carried. Are you ready for the main motion now? All those in favor of the motion as amended, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion is carried and is unanimous. And you have your approval. And if you could wait just a minute to have a dated receipt and several things to collect from the secretary before you leave back. I think that sets the record for our approval process, and I'm glad to see that our new subdivision ordinance is working as well as it is.
Could I ask one question on the electrical service? Did you just want documentation that it existed or to the condition
yes,
or something?
Yes,
okay, I have a plan that evidently is a little bit later than yours, and we did add that on our plan, and if I'll provide copies of that to the town to show that.
That would be helpful. Thank you very much. Our next item of business is Elizabeth Farms, and they are coming in for an amended approved plan.
Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Weincheck.
At our last meeting, which was 2 months ago, it was brought up by the board that perhaps we ought to look at from now on, I think I heard, amendments to subdivision plans as going through basically, but perhaps in a more abbreviated sense, the same checklist that the original subdivision went through. With that in mind, Tom Greer from Pinkham and Greer went ahead and prepared a letter that was dated February 26, 1988, which I believe everyone got a copy of. I'd like to, I guess, get a feeling from the board as to their pleasure as how I should deal with this. You want me to go through this checklist, or have you read it?
I think we have certain points of discussion that we would like to.
Fine.
I'm sure we have some questions from other board members. I have a few questions. I think we're still dealing with a little pasta here as far as the design of lots, and it's pretty thin pasta. And I know that you had a partial answer to that last time. I wonder if you could comment further on that. Tonight, it seems as though the construction of those lots, which are prior to the circle, the park circle, are not as much in harmony with the rest of the development that you have on that site, and I just wonder if you'd like to comment on that.
Maybe first I'll ask you to tell me what you mean by not in harmony.
The design of the lots are narrow and skinny. They are also perhaps inhibited by the view easement line that comes through them, whereas the lots over on your original Elizabeth Farms and over on the Coalfield side are of a much more spacious nature, and seems as though it's a much more pleasant view.
One of the reasons is the change in the subdivision ordinance from a lot dimension of 100 feet, or was it 200 feet, excuse me, through the building from lot line to lot line, to the current condition of 200 feet of frontage. So there's a certain amount of gyrating of the necessary number of lots which we needed to make the thing financially viable to conform with that. As you go around the curves in the first part of Prout Manor, whatever it is now, excuse me, some of these lot lines get a little bit twisted to conform with that. As far as them being long and narrow, the 80,000 square foot rule would have left an irregular line running through the middle of the space between the view easement and the place that we chose, which was simply a continuation of lots 23, 24, and 25, I think, just to have some boundary that at least all these neighbors would be able to agree in their own minds as here's the back line, and from there on there's no specific owner, no individual owner, I should say. Specifically, the association will own it.
Do you have something that compares the last configuration with this one?
The last configuration, before this was a seven-lot subdivision. And basically, things through here, through these lots, stayed pretty much the same. There was another lot here.
You don't have that with you here.
I think I may. I'll bring it to you. I guess we basically felt that that island lot, number 37 on your plan, didn't really have any good access to it because of the grade change that runs through there and the blasting that's required through the ledge to put the road in. That little knoll that makes up that lot 37 on that plan is not one that we felt we ought to be disturbing. Do you have anything you want to add to this?
Lot 32A, 122A, 31 square feet. You've got a 30-foot sewer easement laterally to the horizontally to the property. And then some sort of dotted line in the back with sewer easement again. And then a few easement lines. Well, that 30-foot sewer easement is an existing one that will be there.
The 30-foot sewer easement is an easement that is particular to this amendment, not in the existing plan, and it is to have a force main from lots 36, 35, 34, and 33 to get to the pumping station, which is located on 31A, where the sewer easement major sewer easement, excuse me, intersects with a 30-foot sewer easement coming up from lots 31, 30, 29, and 28.
That sewer easement, that is the large area of the
leach system. Yeah, the infiltrator system. That 30-foot sewer easement will have a 2-inch line in it.
Where do you build the house there?
in that little window about 50 some odd feet wide, there's a distance marked on the plan 35.7, and then a diagonal line 19.20. Anyway, that corridor in there. That's how really all these lots were configured, as the original 30 were also, and the multiplex units were, as we went out and found places that we could feel comfortable putting a house on, made lots fit around it.
It seems like a lot of constrictions on that particular lot.
It is a lot of restrictions. It happens to be about the nicest view lot in the subdivision. That's where our 100 and...
To merging that lot, another one?
I've made the decision to make this subdivision after a lot of consideration, and merging from 16 to 6 is a significant compromise for me. Unfortunately, there are some real restraints on the liability of this whole thing relative to the letter that you have a copy of 2 months ago regarding the division between my former partner and myself.
Can you elaborate on that a little bit?
I'm sorry?
Can you elaborate on what you mean by that?
He owns this lot, the multiplex lot. I have an option on it, and in order to pay for the option, 6 is an absolute minimum number, so we've considered merging lots this way, putting a spur out to get another tier to develop a 6 lot somewhere. We tried getting rid of 2 lots down here and expanding on the concept of the island lot, and I think you'll find if you try to push these triangle and rectangular spaces around as much as we have, that to get 6, this is unfortunately about the best that I think can be done. And the individual house sites are all good.
We run the risk of having something, houses are all built, which isn't different than a row of houses.
Well, except the topography is pretty erratic vertically. The elevation from this little house site on this rather large lot is quite a bit higher, 20 or 30 feet, than the house sites of the two adjacent lots. And from here it goes downhill to a point in here somewhere and then comes up quite sharply. I don't have my topo map here, but as I recall, this is like elevation 30 or something. And the elevation on this lot is 62 or 65 or something. So there's a lot of variation of, a lot of distance between the houses vertically, as well as good natural tree growth through these three lots, and a quite steep slope coming down off the top of the knoll in this direction back toward the brook.
Last time we had something that looked like this was the project next to Jordan's up there on across from the strawberry fields. And now that, I think with some hindsight, we could have done a better job. We've seen those houses on Route 77 sort of all look alike, and they're basically, you know, one might be 40 or 50 feet behind the other one, but you get, I think, the worst of the spaghetti-type lot approach. I guess I'm searching my own mind for some way that we can, when it's all done and built, that we don't have a repeat of that problem.
Well,
I don't know if you can do any more than just tell me what you told me.
I really can, other than to re-invite you to another site walk. I think that the members of the board that attended that site walk last month may be able to shed some light on this at least as well as I can. We did walk right down through and identify the property lines and the house sites. Not all the house sites, most of the house sites.
Certainly the topography is varied, and as you suggest, there are height differences, but I think what the planning board might worry about really are restricting the buyer somewhat by purchasing one of these lots, and he's got quite a piece on each one of them on which he's not going to be able to do anything on. The fact that the actual ownership of the lots are so peculiarly skinny compared to the fatness and the desirability of space around others, I think is not quite as appealing as what you have done perhaps in the other parts of your development.
I think what we're doing here is substituting some of that whole land ownership within a yard by yard square or more rectangular piece of property with the more desirable view pieces of real estate within the subdivision. And I think a very good compromise and amendment to the existing approved plan for condominiums.
Where's the compromise? Who's compromising?
All of us. If I had my druthers, I would, I think, have one less lot and be able to make it all make sense from a business standpoint. I'm not in that position. I truly wish I was, because I agree with you. If two of them, particularly not where you say, but down in here, where there are no treat areas, were merged, I think the whole thing would be a lot nicer. It's going to take some very careful landscape planning in this area after the house is built to avoid the monopoly board look, where there's long spaces from one side of the board to the other and all the houses lined up in a row. I think that's not a task that we can't handle well.
I guess I'd like to hear other board members' views on this whole issue, if anybody else has any feelings.
I've got one question. Do we have a drawing that shows how this fits into the rest of the project? Have you done something like that?
We have not submitted a plan like that. And the reason being, I think the approach that we want to take this evening is somewhat along the lines of the subdivision approval process, to get something in the way of a preliminary approval this evening on the concept of this six-lot subdivision relative to the rest of the lots. Talk about some of the restrictions on the original subdivision. And then next month supply you with a new subdivision plat of all the lots and all the roads and all the easements and all the meets, bounds, and distances and the whole normal final approval format ready for signature, hopefully.
Well, that's one question. The other question is, you mentioned, if I understand the business relationship here, that you have an option on these, the land that is occupied by these six lots, from your
former partner.
I guess, Steve, my question would be, is it satisfied right title and interest? Do we have that requirement satisfied here?
The requirement was satisfied at the last meeting.
November.
Maybe even before then. I haven't rechecked to see if those agreements still are in effect, but I think they are. I think they're going on through the end of the summer.
Yeah. October is the deadline.
Okay.
Mrs. Guthrie?
Just one little point of curiosity.
Have you installed any of those plastic pipes yet? And the pumps? And I wondered if you were...
Plastic pipes?
The plastic pipes that we okayed maybe 6 times.
Oh, yeah. There's a system for the first 14 houses that's installed. Pump stations are in and actually got wired and tested today. Really waiting for the frozen, unearthed portion of the landscape to be unfrozen so it can be replaced, but otherwise operational.
Well,
I'd be happy to show you them if you want to come by for a little septic tour.
I think one of the things I would like to see, following up on whoever suggested, I guess it was Ivan, that we see the whole thing together, is I get some vague recollections of what you tried to do for our Greenbelt plan and the public access and trails, and I don't know how that fits in with what we've got here.
Well, I mean, just to capsulize the changes, okay?
No, but I understand what you're talking about, but how this fits in with what you get over on the other side, what's already up there now.
What's over in here? Oh, I see.
Do people all of a sudden come to a place where they hit somebody's property line, and what we tried to do with the hiking trails and easements stops, or does it continue, or is it this a separate parcel that's not related to it and doesn't need to be? I don't expect the answers, but I think it's important from that standpoint.
Well, I think I can answer those pretty easily, in just simply by saying that in the approved plan, there are three lots in this distance from here to halfway into this fourth lot. So these three lots have been squeezed together slightly. The rest of this obviously is all new, replacing the multiplex units. The easement, pedestrian easement going out to the conservation easement, which allows for hiking, jogging, picnicking, and whatever else, everything but construction basically, is in not quite exactly the same place, but I think it moved from something in the middle of this lot over to there. And all the rest of the trail network remains unchanged.
So this still connects up to that?
Yeah, it does. And the view easement and the conservation easement lines are unchanged. We had four buildings and three houses in this section before. And now we're going to have six buildings and three houses, nine houses replacing 16, 19 condominiums, 19 otherwise units, excuse me.
The conservation line that you have shown on the map and the view easement line were as originally proposed. Could you tell us what can occur on the southern side of that conservation line?
What could occur on the southern side?
Yeah. What happens in that conservation space?
There's still in the over in there's a field that runs around dog leg around in this corner that we set aside in the original conservation easement as a place where if the association so decided, I think by an 80% vote, to build a tennis court or horseshoes or some other sort of recreational facility like that, they could do that back there. Other than that, we can mow the field and bale the hay, and that's about it. People can walk out there, and I think that's it. Dr. Rand's still here. I bet he remembers this better than me. Not much.
There's an agreement with some entity to provide some public access to that space?
Yes.
Okay. Now,
land trust. That agreement is in place and filed and...
How does that working. Then exist with now a private dividing up of that property subject to the conservation easement that allows public use of those people's property?
Right.
Interesting concept.
Thank you. I didn't, and our council didn't see any particular problem with that as long as it was made clear in the deed. Dan, you know something about this. Do you see any problem here with that?
You said thank you very quickly. That wasn't a compliment.
Well, I thought about it at the outset of the whole, at the outset of the subdivision. I gave it some thought and I asked around some people more experienced than I am with this, and it seemed to be a very simple way and safe way, relatively safe way, to get rid of a problem that I didn't want to inherit, a condition that I didn't want to inherit, and that was building condominiums. And still letting people use the land to the extent that they want to. The rest of the field to the south of here is privately owned by the association, was in the original approved plan, and still is under this plan.
Why did you do that with an 80,000 square foot requirement? Why did you take it back to the line that you did? Is it that you couldn't get 80,000 square feet without intruding on the conservation area?
That's correct.
With six lots?
With six lots. Or probably with four lots.
There's just not enough space there to give the number of units without going the condominium, without going the multi-unit structures.
Right.
That's what you're saying.
Right. Now, at one time we had, I don't know how long ago it is now, maybe a year and a half or 2 years ago, we had entertained the idea of mixing single family lot ownership, I think, in the Coalfield section here, and cluster in this whole side of the water and power line easement. And that was pretty strongly rejected in concept by the board, and we flipped over to whole ownership. I think that was a good idea. I'm glad I listened to you at that point. I'm trying to listen hard here. I've done a lot of homework on this problem.
Are there any inconsistencies with the land trust conservation easement and now parceling off and transferring private ownership, any of that?
No, it always was private ownership. The only
association.
Thing, yeah, association. The only thing that we need to do as far as myself or any of my consultants can see is to amend the subdivision plan, have the board's approval.
Dick, is your question that there's a conservation easement given in some fashion to some pre-existing entity, whether it's the association or whatever, and these lots in order to get the size that they need are conveyed part of that conservation easement, which was conveyed to some other entity?
Yes. Yeah. The association, but then are some rights granted to the land trust for that property. Now it's being divided off and sold in fee to individual owners. And I mean, that's an issue that we've got to look at to see what kind of complications that gives.
I guess one thing we could ask...
Clarify that with a town attorney, if you'd like.
That's a legal question, and maybe rather than tie up our attorney,
yeah,
we might want to get an opinion, at least have him answer that question through his attorney as to why the pre-existing grants of the easement aren't infringed in any way by giving them to somebody else.
I think that's a good point.
Yeah.
Would help clarify the situation. Have you received DEP and Central Maine Power agreement to this change or amended idea?
Tom, you want to just answer the DEP one first?
The submittal
to the DEP for the septic system change included the six-slot option, and the septic system that got approved was for the six-slot option. I called the DEP to confirm that they had recognized that, and there is no place in the correspondence specifically mentioning the reduction of 16 units to six lots. So we have filed again for an amended application to confirm that their approval does include that change, so that we have approval for the septic system for the six lots, but not for the configuration of the six lots themselves.
And Central Maine Power, do you have that answer?
I have for you here a letter from Central Maine Power to me back at the end of January requesting a couple of things, like hold harmless agreement, and also a new easement, just incorporating all the old easement participles and the new ones from Mark Curtis. And Mark has had our new easement for a while, and I've signed and returned this letter back to him indicating I am in agreement with him. He was going to deliver to me before tonight, but they're called out to some family emergency out of town yesterday, and I'm certainly confident to have it before next week.
Shortly.
Yeah.
So the DEP is still outstanding as far as the six lot subdivision.
Right.
I think what you're asking the board tonight, if I can understand, is a sense of a feeling of this particular part of your plan, and I think the board has responded that they really would like to see this as it relates to the rest of the plan. I think also probably we would like to have some pretty specific soil evaluation of the park circle eventually, so that we can talk about house siting. And we had a good site walk. We saw the advantages of being able to move the building somewhat to take advantage of either a view or solar. And but I think we need to have that kind of information to see where the building is going to be in relationship to wetlands or potential wetlands and soils that would not support structures.
Have you noticed Tom's response to, where is it? Our proposed amendment number 4 on page 2 of the letter. It's basically a rethinking of what we talked about on the site walk, to say we don't really think that it's appropriate to just have free rein over the lot. We want to keep them generally in the area where we are, but want to have a little more freedom without having to come back to the board each time to twist the house to take better advantage of a particular view, or not run the driveway through a particularly nice tree, that kind of thing.
I have seen that. I think what we're asking for is the definition of the soils in relationship to that building area.
More than what you've already been provided through the original subdivision. I guess I would like to have more specific instructions as to what you want then.
Well, I would suggest that perhaps you can obtain that from
Steve.
Okay.
Very good.
Madam Chair, if I may, the letter you refer to is from Tom. What date is that? Tom Leahy or Tom Greer?
Tom Greer.
Sorry. Okay.
That's when we've been talking. Sorry.
Okay.
Are there other questions or comments about this concept?
Let me just speak about that.
Madam Chairman, it looks like a road line coming into lot 35A on the southern side. Is that any the existing farm road, or is that, what is that?
That's, that was at one time a road between lot 7 and 8 in the first subdivision.
Yep.
That went out to a fire.
Yep.
Lane through the field that once we had a fire in the field, and Chief at that time, Bill Jordan, had suggested we come back and see if we can't quit that because he thought it would make it difficult to fight the fire. But would like that, but said at that time he would like the road to stay there and ramp down the turnaround access opposite lot 3 in the original subdivision so that they could easily drive out into the field with a truck. So that's really fire access, emergency access to the field.
From the other road.
Right. The just for your information, that the from this point, which is the corner of lot 3, where the tennis court was built. And I think that Garfields had come to you some months ago to talk about building a, or maybe it was Zoning Board of Appeals. Excuse me. Anyway, they built a tennis court out here. That is about 250, 300 feet to the old road, just to give you an idea of where that stands.
Was the previous pedestrian easement a 5-foot easement?
Yes.
Okay. Hope they can find it. 5 feet wide. Very long.
I guess we need to see if we can come to some summary here of how the board feels about the presentation of these lots and the configuration. And I guess I would kick off by saying that I'm disappointed that we have to stick to this kind of configuration. I think it would be a lot more appealing if you could at least combine one of the lots with another, as Dan suggested, to try and give more of a similar texture to your development as to the rest of it.
I can make the lots look a lot more like the original lots simply by making them smaller. The old ordinance demanded that the lots be 200 feet wide at the house location, which, for example, these lots in through here are at a certain point, and that's where the house is sited. There's the house approximately, there's 200 feet approximately. Same thing happens as you go around the field. And that's how these lots were configured around individual house sites. We did the same thing through here. And if you look at most of the lots in the subdivision, I realize that's difficult with only a few of them shown on this map. The difference between, the principal difference between the lots is that they aren't necessarily much narrower, they're much longer, and therefore look much narrower. All these lots are at least 200 feet at some point through the lot, and every one of the lots is significantly less than 200 feet. 50 feet, for example, 70 feet, 90 feet, and 70 feet, for example, as are the new lots. They're 200 feet, in these cases, all at the front of the lot, the street of the lot, and none of them are less than 170 feet at the house site. So they're not greatly different that way. The difference is that, the biggest difference, I should say, not the only difference, but the biggest difference is that this lot would need to be shaped like that to be 80,000 square feet. And in so much as there are some problems with the lots being encumbered by all these easements, and to make the lots all more closely to 80,000 square feet would make a very odd back line here. We just simply said, well, why don't we just make them bigger lots? That might help a little bit. And make a straight line back there to try to conform with some kind of good planning here.
We run the risk down in that corner that isn't very wooded, down there, of having four very large houses, because you tend to build houses that are good size, in a row, very visible, which could look like poor planning. At the very least, if we don't do something with the lot lines, I think we ought to consider some heavy screening, possibly some requirements on lot locations, on house locations. The other observation I have before I go, I'm not going anyways, but stop talking, is I guess on hindsight, I'm troubled by a 5-foot pedestrian easement. It really cuts across or against what we've been trying to do. And
no problem.
Anything, pardon me?
No problem. There's no reason why it can't be wider. It runs through other easements anyway.
I think
I'd be happy to make it
15
feet.
And maybe 50.
I'm happy to make it 15 feet, as you requested, and I agree.
I said at least
15. Make it 16.
Coming up to the minimum.
I like it. I'd do that whole easement. It doesn't really... It's not going to affect anything. It happens to be on a side hill, so...
Is it usable where you have it? Is it on a side hill?
Oh, yeah, because the hill runs this way and the easement runs that way, so it's pretty much level as you walk, one leg slightly longer than the other. But a path will, develop there, and that'll be the end of it. It's not the only access to the field either, public access from Sawyer Road, and also from another easement between two lots back here out into this field. So there's three accesses to the field. The window that these houses can be built, is pretty restricted as it is. The 30-foot sideline setbacks are in effect, so where these lots are 170 or so, 180 feet wide at the individual house site, it takes my otherwise normal house, which is real long and perpendicular to the view, my particular design, although I may very well sell some of these lots, and makes it more square than rectangular. So I don't think you have quite the problem of this super big houses that we all read about, partner.
Any other comments by board members on the plan? I think it's important to give any feedback.
I will, but I'm sorry. I just wanted to just finish with Dan's comment before I go over. I will, in the final plan, incorporate some landscape screening requirements for those lots. I think it's a good idea.
Well, I think you've heard from the board that we would like to see if you could do something to enhance these lots of the buildings that aren't going to end up in a row and be in an unsightly, arranged in an unsightly manner. And I think you've heard that we would like to encourage at least a minimum 15-foot pedestrian easement and buffering. We would like you to give some thought to the soils and the building location, particularly when you come in with the second part of your plan or the overall plan on perfect circle, and how it relates to any streams, ponds, and water, wet places.
Okay.
Any other comments?
The road. We had the other part of our site walk was to discuss the vertical change in the road through the ledge cut at, what is it, one of the stations? 150 to, I think, more like 500, right? About a 350-400-foot stretch through there. Like some feedback, if you can, please.
Let's see. Marion, you were on that sidewalk, and I was, and I think Steve Butler was.
Jack Orr.
And Jack Orr. I guess I didn't feel that that was a detrimental to the plan.
Good.
I don't know. Perfectly fine to me.
Great. Thank you.
Did you have any thoughts about that?
Didn't see. I wouldn't say it was perfectly fine with me, but it seemed I would go along with the board's wishes, and I just was referenced back Bob Hunter's letter, the town engineer's letter, and says that when you're having a sharp vertical and horizontal curve, it's less than ideal, and that's probably true, and I leave it up to you to decide.
I think in part that problem is lessened by significantly lowering the traffic on that part of the road, as it turns out now that with six units where 16 were, and these being the only real likely, I think, people to use this road, because most traffic goes to Portland and it's much easier to go out the other way to Portland, that I think the whole road situation at that entrance and the curve and et cetera, is cut significantly, but be that as it may.
Fine. Is there anything else that you want from us? We will probably have our town lawyer investigator look at the relationship of the easements to the six lots and just see what he would advise us.
If you'd like, I'll take the ends suggestion and have our council answer the question of how the two relate and forward that to Tom Leahy.
That would be good.
And wait for a response.
Thank you very
much. Thank you.
Runaway Farms, and we've all also run away from the time, I'm sorry to say, but we have a minor subdivision review coming before us, and a representative of Runaway Farms.
Yes, good evening. My name is Lawrence Eubank. I'm seeking to develop this parcel. We were before you last month with what we thought was a completed application, and you asked for clarification on two items, a more complete detail of the septic designs and a legal description of the conveyance of the Lot 5 to the Town Conservation Commission. And we have provided you with those items, and therefore I'm before you tonight to move this process along.
Fine. Did you have some more presentation then?
Not unless you need it. I mean, if you wish a.
That sounds good to me.
It's fine.
We have a application completeness checklist in front of us. Do you have a copy of that? Probably not.
I believe.
Do you?
Yeah. To our knowledge, everything was complete, and with the exception of a legal description concerning the conveyance, and the Mr. Butler, the planner, asked for a bit more information on the septic designs, which land use has provided to
right.
you.
Right, and it does look as though we may have arrived. at that point, we have a letter. You all should have a letter in front of you regarding the transfer of lot number 5 to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, with an expressing intent that that it will go as a conservation easement to the town of Cape Elizabeth, with restrictions on it, so that that would certainly be a desirable goal of the town. And I believe that we have satisfied the septic system has been met, so that I think we really only have perhaps 2 or 3 points here of discussion. We, I think, might want to set a public hearing in order to, we had set one up, but then it seemed everyone was had to back out. So we might want to go on a site walk I think we want to further clarify the distinction between the driveway and the pedestrian easement going in to the property, so that, and I know we talked a little bit about that last time, and maybe you can just explain what your thoughts are on that this time.
May I refer you to Steve Butler, or Steve Long?
Thank you. As Lawrence has mentioned, my name is Stephen Moore. I'm a representative of Land Use Consultants. We've been providing the planning and design, civil engineering, and surveying on this project. And to touch on, I guess, the point in question, in the submission package that we had made to you last month, we had indicated a site distance chart for driveways. The driveway locations are the driveways that are shown on drawing 1 of 3, which are indicated here in gray. And those individual driveways serving lots 1, 2, and 3 occur at the northwesterly corner, in the approximate midpoint of lot 2, and then in just about 20 feet north of the midpoint of lot 3. Lot 4 is the lot that we are requesting a public access waiver on, and lot 4 is served by a driveway. The existing frontage on Spurwink Avenue is 50 feet. Is marked by a pair of irons that are out there. What's proposed is that a 40-foot deeded strip run with lot 4, and that a driveway be located within that 40-foot strip at the approximate center line where it reaches Spurwink Avenue, so that the driveway itself, is proposed as 12 feet wide, and it'll be centered within that 40-foot right-of-way. Adjacent to that 40-foot right-of-way and in a strip along the easterly side of this 50-foot leg, if you will, out to Spurwink, is a proposed 10-foot-wide portion of Lot 5, which will be deeded along with Lot 5 to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. It is that 10-foot strip in there which is intended to serve as the pedestrian access into and out of Lot 5. And the reason for that being deeded in fee interest is twofold. One is the question of permanent access in a non-easement situation. In other words, the land trust has the ability through fee interest to actually own and maintain that strip free from the encumbrances of the owner of lot 4 seeking to make modifications or changes in that area. The other is that it does provide separation for the driveway on lot 4, so that the driveway can come in and work with the existing grades coming in that long finger, that finger being 270 feet long approximately, to get into lot 4, the building site, being here somewhere in the northerly corner. The building windows are specified within each lot. They're on the recording plan. The intent is to keep those building areas somewhat restricted so we can maintain buffering. And in this case, we've set that building window 40 feet off that 10-foot-wide strip to maintain a maximum separation between the house and that 10-foot-wide strip. Our feeling is that, given the topo that's here, this walkway coming in is relatively flat coming in from Spurwink Avenue, and then it goes up several feet and then drops back down and into the parcel and allows access, primarily pedestrian, into that area. I think that separation in design was intended to allow the driveway to function within the standards and yet still maintain a deeded right-of-way.
Questions? Yes.
Madam Chairman, you say the driveway is only 12 feet wide and 270 feet long?
That's correct. This length of this leg from Spurwink Avenue to that hinge point right there is 273 feet.
Somewhere I thought our standards were 18 feet wide.
At the last presentation, we had made a request of the board to waive that standard because of the concern that the adjacent cemetery and meeting house and this public access, if this were widened, it would encourage parking within the driveway. And our request of the board was, we had specific concerns about people coming to use this area that might park in that driveway, or when there are functions at the adjacent areas that might encourage parking within that area. The intent is to pave that all the way in so that it is a secure and passable way into the lot, but that we not encourage parking and lingering out there by a widened entrance area.
I see, but you do have 6 additional feet should it be necessary to widen that road.
We have a total of 40 feet of right-of-way.
Mm.
So, in fact, you could fit a wider driveway in there.
Okay.
If you chose to.
Any other questions? What is the board's pleasure about going on another site walk? Do you want to view the property before final approval?
Madam Chairman, I've walked the land and looked at it. And it's a fairly simple application for subdivision. So as one member, I don't need the sidewalk.
I also wonder, we don't seem to have many issues here to be dealt with. We've had other cases where we've had sidewalks. So I would be willing
to forego.
Madam Chairman, the one issue I just want to raise is the fact that there is an abandoned gravel pit. And I just think that either, at least individually, those people, those members that want to, if it's agreeable with the owner of the property, might want to go back and take a look at that.
Do we have a plan properly located so that we can find that walkway again so we can find that? We want to go ourselves and take a walk.
Assuming
some of our packages that are adequate for that?
I think if you...
Or is it staked out? Or is it staked out?
The monuments are out in the field around the perimeter.
Well, I'm talking about on the road. Can we
on Spurwink Avenue
yeah.
here? Yes, those two monuments there. I think the key item here is there's a telephone pole, which very
okay.
shows up on your plans. And this driveway is very clear in the field. You can see this driveway heading straight back in.
Well, I think
we just got a letter.
Excuse me, could you identify yourself?
Sure. No. My name's Ronnie Dewey. And we just found out about this whole thing here, and I don't know what's going on here. I don't. Aren't you supposed to have 200 feet of frontage to get another lot over here?
There's a provision in the ordinance that says that if you have less than 200 feet, you can apply for what's called a public access waiver to allow access into a lot that has less than 200 feet, and that's what they're proposing to do for that one lot.
And they're going to give you this lot here?
They're proposing to grant it to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, yes.
And for a trade-off for this lot here, must be, right?
No.
Have you people walked this land? Do you know this land at all?
Could you identify where you live there?
Right here, I think. Yeah. Right here, McVean, right here.
We may be having a public hearing, so this will give you an opportunity to
look at this more closely and comment. This is something that the board can do if it wishes.
Did you study? Did anybody say anything about the environmental impact on the deer and all the animals in here or anything? Did you know?
We have not had an environmental impact study done. No.
We just found out about it. All the neighbors around here wanted to come up. It was 10:15 at night. This is all, wow, you know. Developer coming in and taking over here.
Well, I think that you have just suggested that perhaps a public hearing might be a good thing to do, so that your neighborhood can hear about the plans in detail, and we would like to invite your comments.
Just one more thing I want to explain. This is lot four. This is how many acres?
Perhaps Mr. Moore can answer for you the precise lot you're looking at.
The lot area of lot four is 127,252 square feet, which puts it just around 2.9 acres, something in that area.
Yeah.
And you don't need 200 feet of frontage, is that right?
That's
for the waiver.
Right. We can grant a public access waiver.
What does the town intend to do with this land? How are they going to get to it?
There is a way beside the access that will take them into the 19 acres, which will be donated to the land trust.
Well, I don't know. I think so.
Well, we will send you a notice of a public hearing, and we'd invite you to come back and make any comments about the plan that you would like to.
Yeah.
We'll decide when the public hearing is tonight and set a time so that you can get back and tell any of the neighbors too.
Do you know anything about the bedrock in here? Do you know anything about this land, how bad it is in here? Do you know it's been all the gravels were taken off, all the topsoil and this rock, and where's the septic system going to go?
We do have that on a plan. It's and the septic system has been looked at by the code enforcement officer and has been approved.
I talked to an EPA guy in December about this whole area, and he said to have any sewage system in this area right here. But even back in here, these two here is a wicked
well,
question.
These are questions that we would like very much to have you bring out at a public hearing, and we will, I think perhaps it's appropriate now to set that, and let me ask the board, April 19th would be a good time to do that. And I believe we have a motion actually set out before us which has already included that. So our planner has second-guessed it.
Madam Chairman, I move that we order that the application for Runaway Farms 5-lot subdivision on Bowery Beach Road and proposed by Lawrence Hughes, and determined to be complete according to Section 16.23A of the subdivision ordinance. And the planning board will hold a public hearing to set the proposed subdivision as regular April 19th meeting.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Madam Chairman, can we have that fairly early in the meeting so that any public can come in?
The public hearings usually we do try to have at the first item of business, so that would be either 7 o'clock or 7:30. That's at the item for discussion, but you will know.
The notice will indicate the time and location and date.
Well, thank
you. We don't hear that very often.
Let me just state that at the public hearing, that is your opportunity to come in and give us any specifics that you have, and it's most helpful to us if you can come with specific facts supporting your position on this proposal. It just makes it hard for us if there are a lot of allegations and no facts. We have
addition to the planner being familiar with the site, we've also received a report from the town engineer who's looked at things like subsurface disposal and erosion control, so we aren't going totally blind, and you may want to take a look at the application, which was, is quite detailed and is on file here in the town, so that before the hearing, you're familiar with what the developer has said about his proposal, and if you find some things you don't agree with, then we'd like to hear from you.
That's not affordable housing either, is it? I mean, we're building four houses. It's going to be quite a bit of money involved, isn't it?
Well, all of that is available on the application form. You can see what kinds of houses are being proposed and the size of the lot and the topography. And
it's a very thick application form, which we really would urge you people to come here and look at, and Jerry Dagle will make it available to you anytime the town's open.
I think we have a motion, don't we? Have we voted on this motion?
Can I make one other suggestion, because obviously there's some concern out there. You people may want to consider getting together with the developer and talking about your concerns, too. That would be helpful.
We are in the midst of a motion. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It is unanimous, and we will have a public hearing on April 19th, and the application has been determined complete. Thank you very much.
Thank you, board members.
Is there any new business to come before the board? Under other business, we do have a motion which has been put forward to us by the zoning board, and I would just remind the, and you, I hope you received that in your package. It's also included in the motion. I would just comment that this is a really mandated from the state, so it would be advisable probably for us to adopt this unless you have any serious reservations. And this has gone through the zoning board process and is coming to us, and if we approve this, then we will have to set a public hearing for this too, and then it will go on to the town council. This is on a variance, setting a year's limit on the variance, and our motion is in front of you, unless you would like to, maybe it would be helpful if our town planner read the motion. The ordinance. You may have the one and only copy.
They
should.
It's pretty straightforward. It is straightforward out, and I'll just read it quickly. If I could do that quickly. I'm going to read the one section. It's an amendment to section 19.4.7 of the zoning ordinance under subsection A2. In essence, the major, they change the citation to the main state statutes, and also have added a major section which reads as follows. No rights shall accrue to the recipient of any variance unless the recipient records a certificate of variance in conformity with Title 30 of the main state revised statutes annotated, section 4963, supplement 1987, in the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds within 30 days of final approval of the variance. Notwithstanding the recording of a certificate of variance, the recipient's legal rights set forth in the variance shall expire if the construction or alteration involved is not substantially completed within 1 year from the date on which the variance is granted. Drive it to the point.
Could we entertain a motion? It has been moved and seconded, and you have that motion in front of you, actually. The way it is worded, be it ordered that the Planning Board approves of the amendment to the zoning ordinance concerning variance approval time limits as proposed by the Cape Elizabeth Board of Zoning Appeals and sets it for a public hearing at the Planning Board's April 19th meeting. Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. And that's another swift action by the Planning Board.
What else do
you do? You have some other business. I'm not sure we can go swiftly through this.
Just so I guess everybody here maybe is aware that you're not going to be at the next Planning Board meeting, and I'm going to be out of state, which means I just thought about that. We have one disabled member here, or incompetent, whatever they said you were. Incompetent is a legal term, just meaning unable.
Oh, okay.
You come here and be insulted.
No kidding.
Anyway, it sounds like we have three people, and without someone else, we may have a problem.
Jack Orr will be here for the 22nd, and he is a competent voter. So I think we'll be covered. And I have checked with Joel Russ also, so we will have our secretary once more go the round to make sure that everybody is here, because it is important.
Well, you subdivided your house on 10:30.
That's right. It's on the agenda.
If we go on schedule,
we do have two other items of business I'd like to bring to your attention. I have appointed Dick Kinsman as the chairman of the Roadside Stand Committee. Marion Guthrie will also serve on that committee with her broad viewpoint. And this is quite a critical committee to take some action on. You also have two zoning board members serving on that committee, as well as some fishermen and farmers who will help us design an ordinance which will be appealing to the town and also serve the needs of those two groups.
We do push cards too.
I'd like to go on to congregate housing, and we do need to set up a workshop for congregate housing. I would like to couple that workshop with a brief time allotted to consider planning board procedures. I think we have arrived at a stage where we may need to revise our rules, and also give a lot of thought to such things as our attendance at planning board meetings and maybe possibly setting a second meeting time.
Along those lines, Alice, if I might, seeing that I'm going to be chairing next week's meeting, I don't want to get into discussion. We had a little bit of time to discuss this, Steve, Alice, and I yesterday. We were sitting down and planning the agenda for next week. And I just wondering whether it might be worthwhile for the planning board to consider setting a set time each month for a second meeting. If there is no need, because our agenda is not so full, to have a planning board meeting at that second meeting, it would leave us the option of having a workshop or using a program. The reason I like it is that means that I can set my calendar for months in advance, and I know that I can set aside a specific day, two specific days each month for planning board activity, versus the constant hassle of trying to figure out when everybody's available for a workshop. I don't want to impose a second meeting a month on anybody, believe me. My schedule is real tight where that's concerned, but we seem to be averaging two meetings a month anyways. And all I'm saying is, does it make some sense to make it a scheduled meeting?
Well, I would think it would.
particularly with Conference of Planning Committee ongoing, the Harbor Committee ongoing, congregate housing issues coming. There are a lot of very substantive issues in this whole town, and the Planning Board should be an activist and serve a proactive role in all of those functions. And it would be appropriate to have at least a workshop. I think you're right on. And maybe it's the first and third day of Tuesdays.
Well, whatever. Something we can count on.
Sure.
Well, I'd like to slant on that. I think we need to, and I'm as guilty or guilty as most, to do something about workshop attendance and just plain brainstorming sessions. On the other hand, I would be very reluctant to set a second day for the convenience of applicants who come before us, because there are many, many communities that limit their agendas to a reasonable amount. And if somebody doesn't get there on time, they go on the next month. So I think if we're going to take two times a month, one ought to be for our purposes, not for the developer's purposes. So I hope.
Well, there's another side to this too, Dan. I would suggest if you go with that, that we limit, as we did tonight, we limit our meeting to 11 o'clock. Move from 12 to 11.
And people will go to the next month?
The next month. If there's not enough, or if there's, but if there's enough items, and we can turn this.
Obviously, we have some varying views on this. I think we're all perhaps agreed that we may need to set a second time, whether it be for workshops or for a, you know, to involve some applicants too, is a question. I think you all have to think about this carefully, because as a planning board, that really is a misnomer. We do very little planning, and I think it would be very helpful for the whole process if we can encourage this kind of, and we may want to start our meetings earlier also. We may want to go to a 7 o'clock starting time, and as Ivan suggests, close it, try to wrap up by 10:30 or 11, so we'll all be alive the next day.
As we think this through, the next step, if we all reach some agreement that this is a good idea, the next step to pass along a resolution to the town council accordingly, and are they the ones that enact it, but we have the power to set up a second time?
We have the ability to call our own second meetings.
I think we can establish our own rules. I think we can talk about what time we want to start, whether we want to have meet twice.
We don't need town council approval. Okay.
So let's put that on our workshop. And what date would you like? What Tuesday would you like to choose?
First.
The first Tuesday, which would be in
far away as from our regular meeting as possible.
Yeah,
April 5th.
I won't be here April 5th.
But
we'll start in May. You will be here or won't be here?
I will not be here April 5th. How about the 12th?
Here we go.
I know, I'm sorry. What? Okay, Steve on my left can't make it.
Guess that's Ivan's point.
Yeah. If we started in May, and this might be a way of doing it,
I hate to put congregate housing off that late. Do you think we can do that?
No, I think you're right, because they have some issues, and we've met several times in workshop.
And we're quite slow on that.
It's really wrapping things up.
You gotta get
roadside stands for the summer. Mm-hmm.
I would like it if we could set another meeting in April for a workshop, even though it isn't a Tuesday. How about Thursday the 7th? I will just make it that.
Conservation Commission.
Conservation Commission, sorry.
How about the 14th?
The 14th? Thursday the 14th? How does that sit?
I can't be there.
What days do we have now?
How about, is the 19th our regular meeting?
Yes.
How about Thursday the 21st of April? Are we hitting something that sounds so...
It's vacation week.
That week.
Right.
That's the week of vacation that will be gone, I think.
Can we go?
Is our regular meeting during vacation week?
Yes.
Would you like to go back to the 14th, even though Jane can't be here, and see if Marion can keep copious notes? Or Dan, who's our secretary?
I probably will be gone on vacation.
Let's go back to the 14th.
Okay.
April 14th is going to be a regular meeting.
Workshop.
Workshop.
When's our regular meeting?
19th.
That's vacation.
Yes.
Do we want to see if there's going to be so many people gone that we better do something about that?
How many people would be gone on the...
19th, how would
be gone?
Dick and I and the three of us.
Okay, then I guess we better shift. Could we put the...
Yeah. About a week from the 19th.
We have set a public hearing, two public hearings for the 19th, and I guess we would have to change them, because I would prefer to offer you with the full board.
Okay, why don't you take it? Take a look, guys.
How about putting the planning board meeting on the 26th? Of April.
That's zoning board night, and yours is the same thing we have.
Yeah,
you've got me doing two meetings the same night.
Yeah.
What about Thursday,
that's still at vacation week, isn't it?
Yes.
Well, I can
do that for that.
Yeah, one more.
What?
I can
do
one more.
Which time?
On
the 21st, you could
be
here.
Yeah, but that's not
going to
be
enough.
It's vacation
is
still
going to
have three members.
Well, there'll be Joel, Russ, and Marion, and our new voting.
Children on vacation.
That's Joel's got juniors in college. That's college shopping week.
Yeah.
I don't know if Joel's going to be. I may be back, but yeah, that's
going to
be.
Shall we skip April? Well, let's put the workshop on the 14th, and how about Tuesday the 12th is a planning board meeting. Are you gone that whole week?
No, just Tuesday.
How about...
Al, see you here the 19th?
Yes.
Mary? Joel? You'll be here. You've got four members.
But we better check on Joel before you make that commitment.
With two public hearings? I guess, all right, let's try for the 19th, and we'll see if Joel Russ, if he can't make it, I think we're going to have to change that, and we'll send a notice.
For what?
Fly in from anywhere. I would think we'd have to go to Wednesday the 27th of April.
Yep.
I'm so mixed up now.
We are going to have a workshop on Thursday, the 14th. Would you like to start at 7?
Yep.
And we'll discuss congregate care and also planning board procedures. And then we will continue with the 19th, checking with Joel, see if he's here. And if that doesn't work, we'll move to the 27th. Of April. Any other business? We are adjourned. And thank you for bearing with our long hours. You see what we put you into.
Thank you very much.
I think you just got really clever.
Well, that kind of did very interesting.